Wheels Along the Road is supported by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles.
Good evening. Welcome to Wheels Along the Road here on BCTV. We are live the first Tuesday of the month at 9 p.m. And Wheels Along the Road is brought to you by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles. And if you would like to contact us at the Boyertown Museum, you can take a look on your screen there and see a couple different ways. You can send us an email, mail, M-A-I-L, at boyertownmuseum.org, or you can contact us by phone, 610-367-2090. If we'd love for you to visit our website, boyertownmuseum.org, or our very active Facebook page, or our very active YouTube channel, or our Instagram page, or even better, come visit us in person at 85 South Walnut Street in Boyertown. So we're open 7 days a week, 9:30 a.m. to 4 p.m. And we would love to have you. It's a great time of year to come visit. Mm-hmm. I think it's always a great time of year. The weekend before was Hoods Up weekend, which was a great weekend. We had a lot of visitors. If you came out and saw us for Hoods Up, thank you for supporting us. And if you didn't, stay tuned because we will have another one sometime this year, at least one more this year in 2022. So
one more.
At the very least. So you were there.
I was there.
For Hoods Up. Mm-hmm. So, again, if you don't know what Hoods Up is, that's when we open the hoods on our cars and trucks, and you get to check out all the engines up close. And it's really cool because there is some oddball stuff at the museum. So stay tuned for another date for that. And like I said, if you did come, thank you. We appreciate it. So as far as events go, I don't really have too much new.
So anyway, I don't
right
know
now.
If you realize this, but that street over there is one way. Now, when I left here last month,
Yes.
I went down the street that direction.
You didn't
well, it's
way,
one way
you?
That way. And I didn't know until I committed myself, and there's a guy traveling
oh,
right
no.
towards me. It's 10 o'clock at night, it's dark. What am I going to do?
Oh, no.
He puts his high beams, he just flashes his high beams, like
hello?
Telling me I'm yeah. an idiot for going. I'm thinking, what do you do?
What do you
I'm
do?
I'm not going to turn. I just kept going. And he just moved over, and I just kept going to the next block. And but I learned my lesson.
That's right.
It's 4th Street. It's going that way. And then I noticed today, driving down, is like all the even numbered streets go that way and all the odd ones go that way. Unless it's 5th Street and then goes both ways. And
that's
so
really
that
important.
Was kind of confusing today trying to find a parking spot.
Yes.
I pretty much
double
toured
check,
the whole city.
Triple
okay.
check, make sure you're not yeah. going the wrong way.
Yeah, so, okay,
anyway. I've done that too, it's terrifying. And then I feel horrible.
Well, I wasn't terrified.
I'm
I didn't feel terrible
terrified.
Either. I just, yeah, what do you do? You just
no
oh,
remorse.
Well. Yeah, you go, well, you know. No animals will run over or anything.
You know, so. I feel there needs to be like a universal gesture for, oh my gosh, I'm so sorry when you're driving.
Yeah.
You know, there's gestures that aren't so nice, but
yeah.
there needs
well,
to be
he,
a,
oh,
I'm sorry.
Well, I don't know, but it was night, so you couldn't see.
That's true.
You know, and that is kind of a dark street.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Okay. Anyway, you were making an announcement.
We should do a show on that. No, I was thinking how we don't. At this time, really have any immediate upcoming events. We have a few things that are in the works.
Hershey's coming up.
Hershey, how many days?
October. I don't know. I start counting. Okay.
I think they make
anyway.
An app for that.
Yeah.
But save the date for our electric vehicle show, a current event 2. Which will be June No, I'm sorry, July 17th, that's a Sunday, at the museum. So we're getting some cool stuff lined up for that. So keep that date in
mind. Speaking of that, and you were mentioning the Hoods Up weekend a couple weeks ago. There was a husband and wife with their daughter and the father of one of them came in, and the man is really into alternative powered vehicles, steam vehicles, electric vehicles, and he has some as well as he creates
some.
But they look just like, and he was showing me something. It was a little thing that ran on the railroad, and I forget the story, but anyway, he used the blueprints from, you know, 120, 30 years ago, and he creates this stuff. And of course, I told him, July 17th,
come. Please come.
And, you know, and I said, he was really, they were interested. Ooh. They lived down in Maryland, so hopefully.
Oh, I hope so. That's not far.
Yeah, and they were telling me, what's the place in Delaware that has the steam cars? Starts with an H.
Marshall. Tom Marshall.
Okay. Yeah, but there's, well, but anyway, yeah. It's that place.
It has I think it has like three names.
Yeah.
Because I think it's owned by like the state and part of a park.
But they have a lot of steam vehicles there, and he helps out or something. I forget how it is now.
Yeah, hopefully we'll have good stuff for him.
All right. Sorry.
No, it's a cool show, and we hope to see you there. So July 17th, mark that on your calendar. And then, of course, Duryea Day is coming up Saturday of Labor Day weekend. So we hope to see you with that, too, whether you're bringing your classic or you're just there to look. There's plenty to see, and we hope to see you at those two events. So next month, maybe I'll have some more things to note or more details about those two. So anyway, that's that. And I guess we'll proceed with the show then.
Go on with the show.
And the show must go on.
That's it, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's a Three Dog Night song.
Okay, so am I on then?
Sure, go ahead.
Okay, I read this in the Standard Catalog of American Cars, 1805 to 1942. If you're interested in old cars, you need to get this.
And great book.
I don't know. I went online and was looking at it, and I think they're like $40 and on up for a slightly used one. But still, it's worth it if you really like this stuff. And they started with that, I think, and then they went to one that was 1945 to 1970.
Yeah.
And then they did another one, 1971, and newer, and they did one for trucks. And I think that's all they did. But they're great resource materials. Anyway, I'm going through it. This is like 5 years ago, 10 years ago. I can't remember.
My.
And something caught my eye, and I wrote it down word for word. I'm going to read it to you, and I'm going to tell you the tale I had of investigating this. It's called, the heading for this car is called Havana, Paterson, New Jersey, 1905. During the late spring of 1905, the Havana Automobile Company was organized in Paterson with a capital stock of $500,000 to manufacture automobiles and to operate an automobile freighting business in the Caribbean. William Sheck Jr. of West Nyack, New York, and Louis H. Pink and Walter Moffat of New York City were behind this venture. There were some Havana vehicles built, both trucks and large touring cars, though they were not produced by the Havana Automobile Company. Instead, they were manufactured by Mack Brothers Motor Car Company of Allentown, Pennsylvania. A news release from October 1905 indicated that 10 Havana passenger cars built by Mack were shipped to Havana, Cuba, to be put in service there by the Havana Automobile Company. There you go. Did you know about that?
Yeah. No.
Yeah. So again, it's a company that's headquartered or has office in Paterson, New Jersey, but they contracted Mack Trucks, which was in Allentown, to build them.
That's crazy.
Okay. So I do some investigating here, and this is out of a magazine, Horseless Age, of October 18th, 1905. Mack Brothers Motor Car Company of Allentown, Pennsylvania, are building 10 passenger vehicles to be operated in Havana, Cuba by the Havana Automobile Company. Now they said building 10 passenger vehicles. That mean quantity of 10 or 10 passengers?
I was just about to say, that sounds like a small bus.
Yeah, but you know, I think technically if it's 10 passengers, it'd be 10 dash passengers.
So they just mean
so it's 10
passenger
vehicles.
Cars.
Okay. Here's another thing. This is the Motorway magazine, again, 1905. The Havana Automobile Company has been incorporated for $300,000 in New York to construct automobiles and do a general automobile and freighting business in the West Indies. Those interested are William Scheck, Louis H. Pink, and Walter Moffat. Okay, so I'm seeing some things going to the initial Standard Catalog of American Cars thing. They got their capital stock different, but that's minor. Okay, and then the Cycle and Automobile Trade Journal of 1906 had a long article. It's quite interesting to me. It's kind of technical and stuff, but it was several pages and such. But here's a couple sentences out of it. The Mack Company have 10 of the heavy 5-ton trucks doing service in Cuba, making a 60-mile trip a day hauling sugar. They have 2 more of these trucks completed and ready to ship for the same service. The cars were ordered by Havana Automobile Company, who are the Mack Brothers agents for Cuba, and who have placed an order for a number of these machines for 1906. Okay? So there you go. You got the story here. First of all, it's kind of reading this and reading some other stuff. They mention cars. This is 1905.
Yeah.
I think of a car now, okay, you have your engine or trunk up front, and then in the back you have a trunk or an engine, and you have the passenger compartment in the middle. That's a standard car. Mm-hmm. There's one right there. Okay?
There you go.
But I think in 1905, they really haven't figured out the terminology yet. And they're calling these cars this, and you know, there's other places they call vehicles, okay, which can mean anything. But the cars here, and so I'm thinking, okay, a car like thing. And what they wrote in the Standard Catalog of American cars, kind of made you think it was a passenger car. But it really wasn't. And I've seen some pictures of like buses and stuff.
Yeah.
Okay. And the early Mack vehicles were buses. I think the very first motorized vehicle. Okay.
Oh, wow.
So.
Okay.
Let's go back. Let's talk about Mack Brothers. Okay. There were 5 Mack Brothers, and they founded the Mack Brothers Company in New York City. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure when they were founded. But at the turn of the century, they were already successful building wagons. I didn't know that.
Oh, they started as a wagon builder.
Yeah. Did you know that?
I don't think I did.
Well, now you do.
Now I do.
Okay. 1901, the first motorized vehicle. It was a 1-ton, 15-passenger sightseeing bus. 20 passengers were possible. Okay?
Ooh, squeeze a few more in there.
24-horsepower, 4-cylinder engine. And then it increased to a 36-horsepower engine built by Mack Brothers, the engine. Okay, that was 1901. 1903, a second order for buses was obtained. 1905, remember, they're in New York City. 1905, they moved to Allentown. They moved into the former Weaver Hirsch Foundry Company. And just tonight, before I came here, let me look up Weaver Hirsch. And I came up with something, and a little bit of a mystery, but I don't know. H.G. Schellenberger and Company of Philadelphia, proprietors of the Union Foundry and Machine Company at Catasauqua, Pennsylvania, have purchased the Weaver Hirsch Foundry and Machine Works at Allentown, Pennsylvania, and will put them in operation at once. That was in 1903. So Weaver Hirsch got bought out by Schellenberger in 1903, and then Mack got into there in 1905, 2 years later. So it seemed like it was not doing too well as a foundry. But anyway, that's aside from what we were talking about. Okay, so 1905, 51 vehicles were made that year. All of them, and this is another point of confusion. Remember I was saying the cars versus trucks, vehicles, everything? They're all called Manhattans. I thought the Manhattan was their bus, but it's the model number for their vehicle, which, you know, and you have to carefully read this, and it's like, oh, okay. But they were making buses, and they were making trucks, and you look at it, and they're using very, very similar chassis on it, different size, because they went from 2-ton to 4-ton to 5-ton. So that was it. Huh. Okay, so the Manhattan, they also include an F-51 with two delivery-style trucks on bus chassis, 1.5-ton and 2-ton. That was in the beginning. Shortly after that, a 5-ton truck was being built, again, called the Manhattan. Truck was designed by one of the Mack brothers. That had a 50-horsepower Mack engine with yet another Mack brother designed a transmission. That engine that was around for about 10 years. Also, it had a starter. It had a spring-operated self-starter, which I've seen them. It says, which imparts a number of revolutions to the engine without relieving the compression. The engine re-energizes the spring and disconnects it ready for use. Okay. I'm going to make a little side comment here that this is just to you, Kendra, but that picture you sent me of the Rambler had one of these on.
Oh,
I'm
really?
Pretty sure if you looked at that. She sent me a picture of a Rambler from 1900-something. You could see pretty much like where a crank of the car is. You had this device, this round cylindrical device.
Oh.
And they were usually started. And I saw one of them a couple years ago. But anyway.
That was totally by coincidence.
By coincidence, yep. Okay, so there you go. You have the organization of this Havana Automobile Company to export vehicles to Havana, Cuba, and they're made by Mack. I told you about the early Mack history, Mack truck history, and they're in Allentown building these things here. And so the next thing I do, and this is where I kind of always have fun. Then you go back and you think, okay, I mentioned three gentlemen here, William Scheck, Louis Pink, and Walter Moffat. I'm thinking, I'm going to look these up, and this is going to be great. Louis Pink couldn't find a thing about him.
Louis.
Walter Moffat couldn't find a thing about him. William Scheck, though.
He make up for it?
Out of West Nyack, New York. I found one line. And I can't even remember where I saw this, but it's like a newspaper thing. Lawyer ends life by shot. William Scheck said to have worried over finances. Oh, this is from the New York Times in 1930. So it wasn't
that. Oh, my gosh.
Yeah. So that's it. That's what I found out about these three guys. Now, also the Havana Automobile Company, I found out somehow that it was Market and Hamilton Street in Patterson. So what I usually do with that, I go to Google Maps and you do the street thing.
Yeah.
And so it's like this T-intersection. And so on Google Maps, basically I'm standing in the middle of the intersection and you look around and there's like...
Oh, street view is great.
Yeah, but it's like, I don't know. There's one kind of imposing looking stone building there. I'm thinking, okay, that could have been around in 1905. that was the Hamilton Trust Company building. So who knows? There was an agent there for these guys called Frank Gledhill. Couldn't find anything about him. Oh, he was He was a member of the New Jersey State House of Assembly from Passaic County. Okay, so that's
You know who was from Passaic?
Passaic County or Passaic?
New Jersey.
The city is Passaic.
The city, I guess.
The Shirelles.
Maybe.
They are.
Oh.
Okay. But anyway, that's not who you were going to tell.
No. So,
who?
Corporal Ager on an F troop.
Oh, okay. Okay.
What would you do without me, Dan?
know who's from Patterson? Lou Costello.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm.
Oh. Okay.
Larry Dolby, too.
All right, there you
Baseball
got
player in the 50s.
Oh, all right, all right.
I think for Cleveland. So anyway, so they are making these two-ton and five-ton trucks and sending them down to Cuba. Now, the reason I know there's 2 and 5 ton is I came across some paperwork from the Mack factory, and it has a bunch of specifications for these trucks, you know, this type of wheel, these kind of bearings, this, all these different things. But like for every 10 items of specs, they might have had 2 of them filled in. And so it kind of is this hodgepodge. But I put together some stuff, and I also read the article in the Cycle and Automobile Trade Journal. And I think between them, I came up with a pretty good picture of what these trucks are. But I'm not really going to tell you all this because it's pretty much detailed stuff. But other than the stuff from the Mack Museum archives, about the 2-ton, I find no reference to it. I just find the 5-ton.
Wow.
But anyway, they had you know, Turner Endless Solid Rubber Tires, which was this whole thing, this whole way to make solid rubber tires so they wouldn't come off the rims, and I'm not gonna get in that. The wheels had a Sarvin patent, the hub did. I'm not gonna get into that, but that was kind of this breakthrough thing. You look at old cars and old trucks, and you have a hub like this, and the axle's coming in, and the hub's bolted to the spokes, and everything's a big unit. And that's kind of the Sarvin patent, sort of. 4-cylinder engines, they both had. The 2-ton was a 30 horsepower, the 5-ton was a 55 horsepower. They were water cooled. Transmission had 3 forward speeds. They had a gas tank. Of course they had a gas tank. 24-gallon capacity, good for 100 miles. That comes to 4.167 miles a gallon, which is not much. Radiator, I came across AZ type of radiator. I said, whoa, what's this?
And AZ.
I don't know what it is. It's Mack's own design. The body color was carmine or bright red on these trucks.
Mm-hmm.
And I've seen the bus, and I just thought of this. They have like a restored bus at the Mack Truck Museum. And I'm not sure if it's the first one or very, very similar to it, but it is bright red.
Carmine.
Which is interesting because Mack trucks are always green. That's like
usually
their color.
Yeah.
Okay. And then all machines were also equipped with 2 oil lamps, 1 tail lamp, 1 acetylene lens mirror headlight with independent generator, a full set of tools, including a jack, 4 extra valves in case you had a valve job on the road, you could replace them, valve springs, 2 extra spark plugs, and a box containing a supply of bolts, nuts, cotter pins, wiring, etc. Something I don't have in my
prepared.
Car. Yeah. Okay. I read earlier from the Cycle and Automobile Trade Journal, 1906. The last paragraph of that article, which again was quite a long article, I have it verbatim here. It says, on the road, the Mack brothers, while not exhibiting at the New York shows, had several of their large cars, see there's the cars, on the outside and demonstrated them to intending purchasers. One of the cars bore a sign stating that it had left Allentown Thursday morning at 9 o'clock, had run to New York via Eastern Pennsylvania, Washington, New Jersey, over the Alamuchi Mountains to Hackettstown, then over the Schooley Mountains to Morristown, Caldwell, Montclair, and Newark, arriving in New York at 7 o'clock, making a run of 100 miles in 10 hours.
Oh, my gosh.
That's one tank of gas, too.
Yes.
The driver said that the mud in places was a foot deep. And the way the car was covered with mud left no doubt in the writer's mind that this was true. This run proved without a doubt that the commercial wagon is a proven success and can be dependent on at any season of the year in any road conditions. That's something we really don't think about.
Wasn't Carmine anymore by the time it
no,
got.
No, it was like a brown, I guess, yeah. So that's it. And I'm gonna say this again. I said it right in the beginning here. The book I got this from, Standard Catalog of American Cars,
yeah.
And you got it's this thick and it's,
oh, yeah, it's a
real
thin stopper.
Pages. Yeah, yeah. Except you don't want to put it. You have it on your counter, yeah. So you can
you'll
read
be,
it all.
You'll
the time.
Be using it.
And written by Beverly Ray Kimes and Austin Clark.
Mm-hmm.
And I've talked to Beverly Ray Kimes at a show once, and yeah. I said, "It's so great to meet." She was like a narrator of the show, and I said, "It's so great to meet you." And she said to me, "She goes, I'm happy to be here. Where else would you see two Pullmans in the same show?" We have two Pullmans in our museum.
Man, she
missed
out.
So you can come to our museum and see two Pullmans.
Beverly Ray Kimes would recommend us.
Yeah. Yeah.
If we were. Yeah.
Yep. And one of those Pullmans is one of the ones we have in the museum now.
Oh, really?
The touring car. Yep.
Those are good books. I also use them.
Oh, yeah.
Frequently.
Yep. I had to buy a new one because I wore my other one out. Yeah.
The pages are thin. I get so excited and I'm turning. I'm like, oh, I'm gonna rip this.
I don't get that excited, but,
I do.
But I'm not you. Okay, and that's it.
Very cool. You know, did we see one of those early buses, Mac buses at McKenzie? Not in some time, but I'm thinking a couple years ago.
I've never seen one. I've seen one in the Mac Museum.
Okay.
And that goes back almost 20
like,
years
it was
ago.
Like a sightseeing bus type of thing.
Yeah, it's open.
Yeah.
It's red. It's long.
Yeah.
But I don't remember seeing it at McKenzie. I mean,
okay.
It's so okay.
Interesting.
That's it.
Cool
it's your
beans.
Your turn.
Cool beans.
Cool beans with a K.
All right. Well, so. I'm good. My topic tonight was kind of brought about by a question that some of the staff people had at the museum about a car that is in the museum. So up there on the screen is the museum's 1937 Chrysler Royal 6 Town Sedan with a body by Durham. Durham was a luxury coach builder, you know, custom work, and they were in Rosemont, Pennsylvania. That's really why it's at the museum, because we do, you know, we try to focus on things built in Pennsylvania. Mm-hmm. Obviously, Chrysler itself didn't have a factory in Pennsylvania, but
nope.
This has a Durham body on it, so that's why it's there. And actually, coincidentally, this photo was taken at the Philly Auto Show.
Yeah, I thought the floor looked different than ours.
It's very bright red, huh? Yeah, this is This is at the Philadelphia Convention Center. We took it there 2018, maybe 2019. But by coincidence, tomorrow we will be taking another car to the Philadelphia Auto Show, our 1914 Touran, which was built in Philly. So if you're at the auto show, come find us and say hello. It's a pretty car. It's a beast of a car. You can't miss it. There.
I found something out really cool about the Touran today, but I can't tell you viewers. It's, you have to wait.
Stay tuned. Not this episode.
No, correct. Another episode.
Further research is needed.
No, it's not too much, but it's just, it's topic for next month.
It's a neat car. Mm-hmm. It was at Hoods Up weekend with its...
It debuted.
Yes, and that was its big debut. So that Chrysler, now I don't know how easy you can tell this from looking at the photo, but it has a very, let's say, unique paint color. It's a metallic. It's not the original paint color, but, and we know that. However, you know, someone was saying, well, it can't be original because it's metallic, and they didn't have metallics in the 30s. So that got us to wondering, when did metallic paints come about? And I'm going to get to that. And that was originally what I was just going to focus on. And then I feel like I didn't have enough to do this. And then I expanded it. And then it got too big. So we're just going to go. We're going to do some early history of car paints and how they painted cars. So how were they painted in the beginning? Well, they're painted a lot like a carriage would have been painted. Sorry, I advanced too quickly there. Because after all, for the most part, the early cars were a carriage with a motor on it. So it would make sense that they're going to kind of do it in a similar way. So most of your carriages and early cars, they're going to be oil-based paint, and they're going to be applied with a brush. And oil-based paints do have nice colors. They're pretty vibrant, but they do lose their luster kind of quickly. So, you know, it was funny. I read an article and they're like, the bright red of the Benz motor wagon, which is from 1886. That's what was just on your screen. The only thing that's really red there is the engine. I wouldn't call that.
And it doesn't look real bright.
Bright
either.
And vibrant. I think it's like a really, like, it's a lot of wood. This is a replica. The original's, you know, this is a replica. But yeah, the only really red thing is the engine. So I'm not really sure what that was about. But anyway, that is a photo of the Fleetwood Metal Body Works in Fleetwood, Pennsylvania. That's the paint shop. And there's a great, talking about books, there's a great book on Fleetwood and has lots of cool photos, and it talks a lot about just the process, you know, what each department, I guess, at Fleetwood Metal Body did. And to quote that book, these gentlemen here, the paint guys, used a 2.5-inch wire badger hairbrush to apply multiple coats of varnish. You can't see those brushes in this photo, unfortunately. I do like how they cover up the wheels, though.
Nor do you see any wire brushes or wire badgers.
I don't see wire badgers often in life, do you?
Probably extinct because they made paintbrushes on them.
That's right.
Okay.
Probably not really well-tempered either.
Being silly.
But yeah, so, and if you read that book even more, now Fleetwood is a luxury car body or body place too, just like Durham. So they do things a little differently than, like, you know, what, Ford or Chevy would have done this.
What year would that be, roughly?
I'm not sure. It says it was an Alco car.
Okay. I mean, I'm looking by the styling of it, and you can't see real well because those guys are in the way.
These guys would get out of the photo. They're always blocking the cars in old
photos.
But
if it's an Alco, okay, it's old. So.
And if you read that, like, they'll say, you know, they do one coat where all the brushing is done horizontally.
Okay.
And then that coat dries, and then the next coat is the same color and everything, but then they go vertically, and that's time intensive.
Mm-hmm.
There's another photo. This is not Fleetwood. This is from the 20s, and I know it's a terrible photo quality-wise, but that gentleman has a brush there, and he's painting this car. Sorry, I don't know what factory that is. Any ideas?
No. Yeah, and, you know, I'm looking at it, and the car looks like it's bare metal.
Mm-hmm. And, it does.
And I'm almost thinking, you know, he doesn't look like he has a big brush either.
No.
And I'm almost wondering if he is, there's like a seam where he is brushing, and he's getting into that seam so it's covered, or maybe it's, well, I don't know. So, all right.
And, well, even this, I mean, you can see this is a slow process. Even if you're focused on quantity, maybe over quality, you know, like a cheaper model, like a Ford or a Chevy, but they're still taking a lot of time to apply this. I just put that in. Obviously, this guy's not in a production facility, but he's just making...
Take a look at the starter on it.
A repair. Look at that.
Mm-hmm.
That's the starter you were talking about. You know what? Yeah. I saw this photo earlier, and I'm like, what is that thing? And there you go.
And to be honest with you, that might not be a spring starter. It might just be a starter.
Yeah.
It could be electrically powered, and that's just where it was, because that's where you would start a hand crank.
Yeah.
So it would replace that.
Cool.
But,
I'm trying to think
what kind of car that is. I want to say Franklin, but I could be wrong.
It's a 1920. Yeah. Well, the license plate is a 1920. That doesn't necessarily mean that. But again, that's not a production photo, but, you know, this was... When your car is brush painted, then you, the driver, can probably fix it relatively...
Good point.
...easily with a brush.
Good point, yep.
So it's not just the application that's slow, it's also the drying time. So this is a big problem. Oil-based paints take a long time to dry. That's a big problem for someone like Henry Ford. And there's other problems with oil paints too. If it starts to yellow, the whole thing has to be repainted because it doesn't have any binding medium, and it's bad. So what is someone like Henry Ford going to do? Because this is not suitable for, you know, what he's trying to do here. We're getting into the Model T era here, and he wants to build a car really quickly and cheaply.
Proxalin.
Yes. Thank you.
I might have said it wrong, though.
I have no idea. Well, he actually starts, he gets these asphalt-based baked enamels. Darker colors last longer, so they don't like have that yellowing or fading thing. And the drying time is shorter. So this is exactly what, you know, Henry Ford wants. But asphalt enamels have a bad side to them, too. Mainly, a stray hair or lint can ruin the paint job. And actually, if you read in the Fleetwood book, they talk about that too, that the guys, I guess, doing the varnish or the lacquer at the end of the process, which is like your clear coat, they would just wear their pants, no shirts, in the factory floor. And they would wet the floor to keep dust and dirt down. And then they would also put oil on their arms because then they didn't want their arm hair to
get stuck in there. Your skin can flake off too.
Yeah.
Showed the picture. I think that was the first old picture you showed, and it was the Fleetwood. You said it was the paint area.
Doing the paint.
Yeah, and I'm thinking that kind of looks, there's the wooden floor, and I'm sure. Yeah, it's just, they're learning the automobile business, as they went through, so.
So this helps Ford, these baked enamel things. And, some paints never even dried out. I also read about Brewster and Company of Springfield, Massachusetts, and I couldn't find any good color photos because they had a really popular green color that they...
Brewster Green.
Green.
Is that where that came from?
Yes.
Wow. Okay.
So, yes, I think Ford had a Brewster Green.
Okay.
Which is just a similar color to what Brewster did. But Brewster ground and mixed their own paint colors from 06 to the late 20s. And it was oil-based, but it did not have any varnish. But this is what I read. Since it never dried out. Can you imagine that? It never.
Never.
Never. Never dried out. So your brush marks are really visible when the paint doesn't dry out. And it was their formula was like a big secret to them. And, Brewster Green was their trademark color. And you'll see other companies kind of copy it in a way. It was like an olivey green.
Olivey green?
Sort of. Yeah, I'd say it's a little more vibrant than that, but I saw olive green. So another thing people start to do after World War I, they start putting tung oil on the car after it's done painted to help quicken the drying time. They also start to use ovens, and they can build some of those into like the assembly or the conveyor, like a tunnel. Like the drying tunnel after you go through the car wash. Sort of like that.
Somebody told me once about a car that was built, and they didn't make a lot of them, but they said it was like a three-story factory building, and the painting was done on the top floor. And they said there was a trough around the room that they burned gasoline in
bring
the temperature up to dry. And, the more you think about it, you think, well, first of all, the heat would be going up.
It must have been really stinking hot up there.
But the fumes and stuff, and I'm thinking, I don't know what these paint fumes do with gasoline flame. But, the more I thought about it, the more ridiculous it sounds. But,
they thought it would work, I could see someone trying that.
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
Terrible.
But anyway, I just had to bring that up. So
I gotta look that up after this. What did you say, peroxylene?
Proxylin.
Proxylin. So that's General Motors starts to work with DuPont.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, everyone knows DuPont in the 1920s to make peroxylin.
I think it's just proxylin. Anyway,
they
made that paint.
Yeah, they made this. So this is a substance mixed with the pigments, so the colors, to make new coatings. And they advertised that they were more durable, and they would dry in minutes instead of hours.
And when was this again?
The 20s. So in 1923... is when Duco paints kind of start to be are advertised or are debuted. So, this is, now they have like a rainbow of colors, and this is the 20s. So, roaring 20s, things are kicking up a bit with the economy is really good. And I don't know, it's interesting too, I'll get into some of this later too, like how the popular colors are affected both by the paint and the technology of the paint, but also like what's going on in the country too. So it's the 20s, things are like flashy and, you know, I mean, look at some of the 20s cars like you think of, like the kind of gangstery looking ones and stuff like that, all the Art Deco stuff. So 1923, Duco paint colors debut at the New York Auto Show. And there's a photo of the 1924 New York Auto Show. You can kind of get an idea how that would look. Really, it's not too far off from an auto show today, honestly. Big convention hall type thing. Cars out.
Yeah, I can see a red rug, too.
Yeah, see that bright red rug? Use your imagination. And GM puts on display the Oakland Motor Car Company True Blue Oakland Sixes using Duco paints. And I have had a heck of a time trying to find a good photo of this, either a period photo or just a car today. This is, I think what I've landed on is pretty close.
Bright.
Very bright. And I don't even think this photo is a great quality. I could think it's tinged like a yellowy or something almost. So, but this is an Oakland True Blue, Oakland 6 True Blue. There were seven of these cars painted with Duco paints. Now, they said that they had red or orange racing stripes. I cannot find this.
Racing? Did they use that term?
That was the term I saw.
I mean, I didn't think that term was invented yet. I can see pinstripe, yeah. But I mean, I don't.
Well, and I see really that little see like detail there at the hub.
Yeah.
But so there's an important, to me, there's a reason that these are blue. That's important. Blue was one of the trickiest colors in the beginning because it yellowed really fast. Mm-hmm. So it was a hard color to get right to begin with. And the combining the two colors on the same body was important because now that you had paints that dried quickly, you could actually make two-tone cars a lot easier. You know, you didn't have to wait 10 days for the one coat to dry before you added the accent. So that was important. So, you know, the 1920s are really going to play this up. This is a Duco ad. Beautiful, enduring finish. I love how, like, the Duco paint things even have, like, the two-tone options like picked out for you. Like this is something they can do now is make two different colors on the same car.
Again, what year would this be?
I'm not sure, 20s.
Okay.
That I believe is a 27 Lincoln ad. You can see like all the colors and like they put the birds in to make it look exotic and, you know, fun and all this. So, That's the crazy freewheeling 20s there. But what, now you see that green car, and I think the blue one does too. It's just closer in color, so it's hard to tell. They still have black fenders.
Yep.
Yeah, that, there's a reason for that. Even on your colorful cars, they like black fenders because the fenders get dinged and scratched up the most. Mm-hmm. So that's easier to repair and repaint with the asphalt paint. So that's why fenders stay black for a while. I read that as the coachwork companies start to fade away, the black fenders do too. Hmm. I think of our Dodge sometimes and how it's like the all steel metal, the one stamped metal piece. Mm-hmm. That would be silly. I mean, it seems like it'd just be easier to not do the black fenders thing when you start getting that. I don't know. That's me just thinking. But anyway.
You know, you were showing the advertisements for the Lincolns there, mm-hmm. and I was thinking the Dodge Brothers advertisements from 28, they had a lot of different colors, mm-hmm. so.
That's really a two-tone. Mm-hmm. There's another example. You know, they start to easier to do. So something else helps out with upping the color factor on cars in the 20s, and that is the spray gun. So now we're going to go back in time a little bit here, back to 1887. So in 1887, there's a gentleman, Joseph Binks. He is the maintenance supervisor for Marshall Field's department store in Chicago. And he is given the task of painting just a ridiculous amount of wall in the basement. It had to be whitewashed. Mm-hmm. And, you know, a brush is taking forever. So he comes up with this hand-operated pump attached to a vessel to hold liquid under pressure, and then he puts it all together with a wand with a nozzle on the end, like a pump-up garden sprayer, you know, that you'd use around. And that's what he comes up with to do this in Marshall Field's department store. And then in 1893, he really gets a lot of attention because there's a little something called the Columbian Exposition in Chicago. And if you can see that picture there, it's really over the top. It got the nick, you know, this was the White City. If you ever hear that, there's a book about this too. I think it's called just the White City. All these buildings need to be whitewashed.
Okay.
It's crazy.
So they use the Binks sprayer.
And they call in Mr. Binks. And he tackles this project. Joe Binks's paint and whitewash spraying machine is what he uses to paint all this with just a few days before the opening. I just think this photo is so cool with that lady standing there looking over the White City. And it gets used for other applications, especially agricultural ones, you know, like spraying, you know, like pesticide, mm-hmm. insecticide type stuff. And then in 1919, Binks makes his first hand spray gun using compressed air. And he actually at first markets it as a way to dye carpet. So he could dye all that red carpet at
there
the New York
go.
Auto Show.
The circle's complete.
But there's another inventor I got to throw in the mix here, too. Oh, I think that's like an early version of what he was doing. Pretty rudimentary, but you can see it looks like that. What you'd use now, your garden hose there. There's another man that we had to talk about briefly in 1888, Dr. Alan DeVilbiss. Okay. He is an ear, nose, and throat doctor, and he's having trouble treating patients' sore throats with a liquid. So he combines a rubber bulb tubing and the base of an oil can to come up with the first atomizer. He's from Toledo. That's why he gets this front page spread in the Toledo News Bee. And his son Thomas expands on it in 1907, and he made the first handheld air-powered spray gun, first used in furniture. But those true blue Oakland Sixes were painted with Duco paints applied with a DeVilbiss spray gun.
How about that?
There you go. The first car to be painted with a spray gun. First production car, I should say. I'm sure someone had a mind to set a spray gun to something on their own. So yeah, and as the spray guns developed too, you know, in the 30s, they both the DeVilbiss and the Binks models come out that allow you to change the colors quicker. So you can just pull off the entire head assembly and with one bolt and put it on another color, and that helps too get things more colorful. We are running out of time, actually, so I'm going to just steam ahead here to quickly the metallic paint discussion. DuPont had a metallic lacquer for spraying in 1927, so a lacquer. And this is what was used on the 1928 Miller 91, driven by Louis Meyer. At the Indianapolis 500. Okay. So that's at the Indianapolis Speedway Museum, that car. That's where this photo is taken. But it's very vulnerable to fading. So in the 30s, Yes, they do come out with metallic paints in the 30s. This is a European car, a Hosch.
Hosch.
Do you know
there's an R in there?
Is there? Do you know what this is? At a museum. Do you know what they used in Europe to make the paint metallic?
Metal.
Fish scales.
Oh, okay.
Yes. They did not go out and specifically kill fish to make the paint. It was like it's a waste product, really, when you're gutting and eating a fish. Now they started using that. They'll use like oyster shells when they want like a pearlescent look. In America, in the United States, they use aluminum flakes. In the metallics. So yes, that did start in the 30s. And that is a Duesenberg with a Bowman and Schwartz body owned by Ethel Mars of Mars Candy. That had a silver metallic paint on it. Metallics get more popular after World War II because during World War II, there were better sun-resistant clear coats developed. I think mainly because of like aviation purposes. Mm-hmm. They came out with some of those that were better. Chrysler comes out with symphochromatic. They're kind of more iridescent maybe than metallic, but those come out in the 40s. And pearlescents have been around since the teens. But they were difficult to apply. And like I said, they used a lot of the ground muscle shells. And then they start using powdered mica. So that's a 33 gram page. They used a lot of pearlescent paints on their stuff. Again, that Art Deco look is just so cool. It looks nice with that kind of a paint job. So anyway, that is a brief history at the very beginning of automotive paints, and I had about three more pages of stuff there, but it's a big topic.
It is.
A lot of it I don't understand because it's chemistry, but it's interesting. So there you go. So yes, there were metallics in the 30s. Our car, that's not an original metallic color, but it could have had a metallic, just not that brilliant of one. So in any case, thank you everybody for joining us this month here at Wheels Along the Road. We hope we get to see you at the Philly Auto Show or that we see you at the museum. But until then, we will be back here in April. And everybody take care. We'll see you at the museum.
Wheels Along the Road is supported by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles.